Thank you for tuning in to Top Shelf with Devin Harris, presented by Hennessy. Today, we're going to be interviewing Daniel Gafford, a.k.a. the landlord, guy from Arkansas. Going to learn about his personal journey growing up in Arkansas, as well as his basketball journey getting here to the Mavs as well. Check it out. All right, Daniel, welcome to the show. Appreciate you coming out, brother.
Thank you. Thank you.
Walk me through your basketball journey.
I was somewhat of a late bloomer, I would say. I had two left feet growing up as a kid, and then hit my growth spurt until, I would say, the end of my seventh grade year. And then that's when I kind of like got into basketball. I did play a little bit before that, of course. You know, that's when clothes were too big. Shoes were too small. couldn't find two socks that matched. But like at the end of the day, you know, I had like a itch for it, but it wasn't like necessarily like a love for it just yet early on, most def. And then come my eighth grade year, I finally tried out for school team. Just kind of like went through the year, you know, finally got a pair of shoes that fit me to be on the court, and then my shoes got stolen. So I had to play half of my eighth grade season in a pair of 14, size 14 New Balances.
Okay.
You know, very, very tough if all my basketball heads out there know what I'm talking about. But other than that, just going through my eighth grade year, we went through like this small little tournament that was not too far from my hometown. And I did good. I did decent. You know, like I said, I was a late bloomer. I was just now getting to the point to where I was being a bit aggressive, I would say, on the floor. And then my coaches was trying to tell me, like, I had a couple of scouts looking at me at the college that we had the tournament at. I didn't know what scouts were. And so once he explained it to me, you know, he told me just what I could do and how I could do it if I kind of like put my head to it. You know, I'm a real big family-oriented person. And when it came to just finding out that I could, you know, use my talents with basketball to kind of like just actually, you know, put my name out there and make something happen for my family, it was something that kind of like, you know, helped me grow like a bigger love for the game. So like from my ninth grade year all the way up to my 12th grade year, it's just, you know, I found myself falling more and more in love with the game, wanted to learn more about it, you know. Was a bit lazy, didn't really work out that much, but it's just, you know, day in, day out, I always wanted to just be better, in all honesty. You know, got recruited to colleges and stuff like that, and I was learning as I went on. But like I said, like I was a late bloomer, played a little bit before my seventh grade year. You know, like I said, that's when I for sure found out that I felt like I wasn't capable because of the two left feet. I was always tripping over myself. I was the laughing stock of El Dorado, Arkansas for a good amount of time because of that. But just getting to, you know, that last year of high school and just going through just like the basketball stuff, finally getting into college, got to Arkansas. I committed to Arkansas my ninth grade year. Got there, did what I did there. I went 2 years in Arkansas. Had a good time there. Most definitely felt like I at least put up, you know, made a good impression for sure for my home state. Then got drafted Chicago for a year and a half. Traded to Washington for 3 years, and now I'm here.
Now, to rewind a little bit, you consider yourself a better basketball player or clarinet? or bass clarinet, bass drum. What changed you from music into basketball?
In all honesty, with the music side of it, I felt like it was going to get in the way. Even though I had like a big heart for it, I wanted to continue to do it. It's just I had to find time to put in for the basketball side and the music side too. Basketball took up most of my time, so I had to put the clarinet and the bass drum sticks down, most definitely.
Were you talking to a fellow? I played the saxophone.
Really? So that was like my dream instrument, yeah. But it was this one guy, he had came. I think he was foreign, came out of nowhere, out of the blue, and was the only saxophone player in our band. But like he was like the smartest kid in like the school at the time. Like it's always stories like he was teaching teachers like the lessons that they couldn't teach and stuff. And just like the saxophone, it just came natural to him. So I was really jealous of him at the time. But yeah, that was like my dream instrument to play.
You were also a wide receiver, yes?
Yeah, ninth grade.
Ninth grade? Yeah. You just gave it a try?
I played for 1 year. You know, it was an experience. like I said, I was very clumsy. I you know, finally got my feet up under me, but I didn't have my hands with me.
Right.
So they had me a wide receiver. I wanted to play defense, of course. I wanted to be like my oldest brother at the time. I wanted to be on the D-line, you know, because he had the height, but he had the size, too, to be out there on the D-line. They wanted me to be out there catching passes, you know. Couldn't catch a cold if it was given to me, though. It was a rough year. Like, the last game of the year, we could have went undefeated that year, too, with my high school. The last game of the year, it was a guy literally that stood at my waist that intercepted a pass from me. I mean, very embarrassing story to tell. Yeah.
No, that's the quarterback's fault, though.
I mean, it was on the money. I don't know how it happened. I don't know what it was. It was a rough night that night, most definitely.
Being from Arkansas, obviously love Southern food. Mm-hmm. If you were making a crab boil, what goes in there? What's your go-to? What do you like?
Ooh. Are we talking about just like the ingredients and stuff?
Ingredients.
Mm. I mean, well, I'll just say just like the usual necessities on just like a crab boil, of course. But it's just like with me, spices, you got to do Old Bay. You got to do just like all the stuff that's going to make you sweat, in all honesty. You can't do anything that's not going to just like not make you sweat. You got to feel the heat for sure. I'm not an expert when it comes to just like the crab boil stuff. But in all honesty, with my ingredients, I'm for sure doing the potatoes, the sausages. It's 50-50 on the corn. Okay. I could, you know, care less for the corn, but I'll take it at the same time, too. And most definitely, like, maybe a couple of boiled eggs, too.
I've never had that with the boil. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, it's fire with boiled eggs. You got to try it.
There we go.
Most definitely. I'm going to just leave it at that because I don't want to do anything to where people are trying to take my card from me.
I got you. You wash it down with what, sweet tea?
Yes.
Yes?
Sweet tea, and I may, you know, get a little natural, maybe grab a Sprite, too, you know.
All right. You're also a big chicken guy, right?
Yeah.
Okay. You've obviously, you've been all over. Mm-hmm. What is your go-to fast food chicken spot?
I'm going to say back home, most definitely. It's called Chickadilly.
Okay. What makes that so special?
Just, like, when it came for me coming up, when it came from like that chicken spot, that was always a spot. It was like right down the street from my neighborhood that I stayed in. Whenever I got any type of, you know, allowance, any type of money in general, that was like always the number one spot to go to. I always got I don't even know if this was order. I just went in and told them what I wanted. I was like, I need a breast, a thigh, side of fries, jalapeno bites, and like maybe like three rolls.
Okay.
And like they were like their large drinks were like abnormal. They were scary large, you know? So when it came to getting those, like, you know, that was most definitely like a four course meal at the end of the day.
Dipping sauces,
I didn't have dipping sauces with just like regular chicken, but of course, you know, you gotta throw some hot sauce on there.
Okay.
For sure. But if it was like chicken tenders or something, we going ranch and barbecue. Most definitely. And like they got like a natural spice to their chicken. Mm-hmm. So it's like you really ain't even gotta have too much.
No doubt. You're Canes? Are you Canes?
Yeah.
Yeah, Canes is.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Cane's guy, Zach's, he's got anything chicken that is good. I mean, at the end of the day, I'm going to just leave it at that.
Okay. Being from the country, what is the most country thing about you?
I would just say my accent, in all honesty. I don't really do anything else outside of just being country, unless I'm back home. That's where I'm more comfortable of just letting my country side out, for sure.
And let's go back to Arkansas. You from Arkansas. You go to Arkansas. You said you had a good time. I've been to Arkansas one time.
Yeah.
On the campus. You know anything about this? I went to this karaoke bar. They said it was like the hoppinest thing on there. You ever been there? It was like a big thing. I watched people perform.
Do you remember the name?
I'd have to go back and
look. Wait, you might be talking about JJ's.
Might be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They usually have
upstairs, downstairs?
I think it's one that has an upstairs, downstairs, if I'm not mistaken. But you may be talking about JJ's because, you know, we got that one street. It's called Dixon Street.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, you're talking about – you got to be talking about JJ's. That's the only thing I can remember of just, like, having somebody up on a stage singing while we were eating.
Yes.
Yeah. So
– fascinating.
Yeah. No, it's dope. They do it big there, most definitely. They do it wild and they do it big for sure.
Okay. Your favorite player growing up?
Favorite player growing up was most definitely Kobe.
Kobe.
Mm-hmm.
Kobe 8? Or Kobe 24?
I think I was around 24.
24?
Yeah.
So you didn't know 8?
I was at the end of 8, I think.
Okay. Eight was different.
Yeah.
24 was a lot more precise. And
yeah.
Eight was just
eight
like
was a different beast for sure.
Like
I always watch highlights of just, you know, when he had number eight. Yeah, I just always mesmerizing.
Very much so. Do you wear Kobe's when you play?
I try to. I don't really think they have them in my size, really. I don't know if they have them in my size or they run out of stock.
What are you,
in my
14,
size.
15? What are you?
15.
15. Dwight got all the...
I mean, that's what I've been told. Okay. You know what I'm saying? So I don't really hold it against nobody. If they don't got the shoes, they don't got the shoes. If they do, I most definitely take some. Matter of fact, now that we think of it, I'm going to actually hit up my guy today, see if I can get some. Most definitely. Yeah.
We need to get any problems, Kobe's. I mean, you know your general manager was very high up in that department.
Hey, so my Nico?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. He's the one that, funny story, when I got traded here, he called me. He was like, yeah, man, I'm the guy that brought you to the Sports Academy camp in L.A. I was like, wow, that's crazy. Because when I was in college, I had went on the college side because I went to the skills one for high schoolers, mm-hmm. You know, had a good time. Got my mom actually to come out when I did that one. But I actually went to the college one, too. And Nico was the one that kind of like put in a good word for me. Him and Mike Anderson are real good friends.
Look where you are now.
Right.
Small world. gaming.
Mm-hmm.
You said you got a nice little setup. I saw, you know, you try to emulate people's setup. Devin Booker, Cat, you try to.
Yeah, kind of.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Call of Duty is your go-to?
Not anymore. I'm really hooked to this game called Helldivers 2.
Okay.
And if anybody out there is watching this, they'll know what Helldivers 2 is. Like, it's a very intense game. Have you ever seen Starship Troopers?
Yeah.
Literally just like that.
Okay.
Like, you know, you get dropped in, you either fighting aliens or you're fighting robots in this for this place called Super Earth, and, you know.
So you streaming?
Yeah. I stream. Whenever I, you know, have the downtime, I stream. Good. 3 to 4 hours a day, you know, whenever the wife lets me stay down there on the game that long, for sure. But, yeah, so I've been streaming, I would say, ever since COVID, first year. So, like, COVID knocked everybody out. Seen a couple of guys in the NBA that was streaming. It was, like, Zach LaVine, I think Jamal Murray, if I'm not mistaken,
mm-hmm.
Devin Booker. They were all playing Call of Duty, and they were streaming.
Right.
I was like, oh, yeah, let me try that. You know, so I started streaming off my little PS4. You know, it's like, okay, I think I can do this. And I started spending money. And I was like, God dang it.
Speaking of spending money, are you one of those guys that have like the little setup that you kind of travel with, the little screens, screens?
I do have a Poga case.
Okay.
It's by this company. They're overseas. I can't remember what country.
Yeah.
But they make this basically a suitcase. It has a computer monitor in it.
Yep.
And all you have to do is put your little PlayStation or Xbox in it.
Plug it in.
Plug it in. You got your little screen. And you can travel with it. So, yeah, I have one of those. Okay.
Do you play 2K?
Yeah. I haven't played 24 lately, but I do dibble and dabble.
What was your reaction? And are you the type of guy that you only play with yourself? Or do you like, you know? Because when my first experience, I'm scoring all the points by myself.
Fact. Right? No, the first thing that I did, I went on NBA Blacktop.
Okay.
Most definitely. And like, I forgot who I played against. It was somebody on my team at the time. But like, for sure, like I spent all day playing like with myself, posting up.
Right.
I was a bit out of shape about my jump shot on there. But at the end of the day, I was just happy to be on the game. And then like on down the road, they put all my tattoos on my body. I was like, this is amazing.
It's real. Nickname, the landlord.
Mm-hmm.
Where does that come from?
It came from Washington. Chris Miller gave it to me.
Because you just control the paint?
Yeah, I was blocking shots and stuff. And then he said the landlord. Then it was like the wrench do part had came out of nowhere. And then we just kind of like made a thing out of, you know, I got a merch line and everything with it too.
That was my dope. Yeah. So how do we get the merch? If I want to get a shirt with the landlord, you know, you got to tell us something.
Of course, you can go on IG, look in my bio. It's Gaff House Shop, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. I don't remember the full URL right now. But if you type in just like Gaff House, it should pop up, most definitely. Then you'll have all the merch on there. I don't know if we got any like of the old stuff, you know, but we should. I think we're actually about to get ready to drop some more stuff too. So it'll be on my IG. It'll be, I don't have Twitter anymore. I deactivated that. Yeah.
You're saying we just missed the rent. The rent due on the first. So we.
Yeah.
Okay. So we got to catch that on the next one.
Most definitely. I got you.
Right in time for the playoffs. You have a close relationship with Gortat, right?
Yeah.
How was he influential to you? I played against Gortat.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you. One of the strongest dudes
out
there. Yeah. Hardest screen sets. Like
when I first actually got to like work out with him, like his gist is just like 101 lifting weights.
Right.
When we first worked out, it was so funny because he said he was out of shape at the time and I was making shots and stuff like that. He was pushing me around and stuff. He was like, "Yeah, you know, you know, you out here shooting the fadeaways and stuff. You just need a simple hook shot. You know, that's all you need. That's all you need. And the Gortat screen, go set the screen and demand the ball." I was like, "Okay, I got you." You know, and then just building kind of like a relationship with him. It was just dope because that's one of the just like the top bigs that's been in the league. You know, he got a screen named after him.
Yes.
You know, and it's just something that I for sure like hold dear to me because like every time he had came down, he used to ever come down like every once in a while in Washington. I think my second year there, mm-hmm. used to always, when Tommy was there, he was telling Tommy, when Tommy used to come tell me this, I don't know if he actually said it or not. He was like, "Gortat really loves you." So I was like, "Okay, cool." You know, it was just like a lot of stuff that he was telling me is just like, okay, this is the stuff that I wanted to actually get better at. So having somebody come in and just giving me those pointers and giving me those tips and just like how they did it and just like with my athletic ability, how I can do it at another level. It was just something that was for sure just like I hold that like dear in my heart for sure, because it's just like, you know, that he did it. Like, he wants to see me do it. So it's just like, I was like his little protege. I was like, "Oh, okay, you know, help me out then, you know?" So I really didn't complain at all at the end of the day. He really wanted me to get up at the butt crack of dawn to be in the gym, though. Mm-hmm. And it's like, man, you know, I think my max was 30, 35 minutes that right. year. That's tough.
Yeah, for sure.
Especially during the season. He wanted me to, like, come in, like, maybe 6 hours before practice to come in and play one-on-ones. I'm like,
that's a
little bit. I get that.
Right.
With how you did it when you were playing. But, you know, times are different. You know, I don't want to change too much up when it comes to the league, but I don't know about 6 hours before.
That's some Kobe-like stuff.
Yeah, facts. Yeah. You know, at some point, you know, I do want to get to that point. It's going to be a long time, though.
Yeah. Speaking of, you said he got a screen named after him.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not mistaken, it's a screen that we use here often.
Yeah.
Did that help when you got here? That part of knowing to use that and how to incorporate that?
Because he, like, literally, even, like, when Brad was there in Washington, he used to just sit there and conversate with Brad and just talk about how he used to set the screens for, like, young Brad when he got into the league and stuff. And, like, how he did it with John, all that. Go up, set the screen. All you got to do is just pay attention if he's going to hostage dribble or cross over. Mm-hmm. And then just literally just go down and just literally just seal your man in the paint. Just let him go right beside you.
Walking the layups.
Easy.
I hated that.
Yeah. You know, I'm still working on mastering it.
Right.
Most definitely. But I do got a pretty good hang of it, I would say, early on.
You went 38 in the draft, right?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think you went to the second round? Were you always considered a lottery pick? Or was that kind of like where you were
to go? I think my first year, I don't know if it was lottery. I think it was just like decent first round.
Yeah.
Yeah. Second year, probably went down because I stayed an extra year. Honestly, I tell everybody I probably should have left after my first year. Mm-hmm. A lot of Arkansas fans would probably say that too. But I don't know. It was a weird feel my draft night because I think the AD trade happened when he had went to the Lakers and stuff. I don't know if that messed stuff up for me or just for like anybody, you know, but that's how I took it. I was like, dang, man, AD got traded, you know, now guys are going to want different people. A lot of pieces are going to be moving and stuff. You know, it was a lot of discouragement that night, but at the same time, it's just like, you know, I just wanted to see my name called, most definitely. It didn't matter how high it was. It didn't matter how low it was. As long as I was given the opportunity to be able to go to the next level and actually be put in a position to where I could take care of the people that were there watching the draft with me. So that's just how I took it.
I'm going to talk about a little bit of your time in Washington.
Okay.
You had a different point guard every season that you were there.
Yeah.
How difficult is that as a big guy when you depend on those guys to kind of get you going? How difficult during the time? Because normally you want to build that rapport.
Yeah.
Right? And if you got a different guy each and every year, it's hard to kind of.
I mean, it was tough because you had a different personality coming in every time. You know, different personality, different play style, different height, you know, at the end of the day. So when it came to just like paying attention to, I would say, certain things like that, you always want to figure out what this guy likes and what this guy dislikes, type of screens he likes set, type of screens. He doesn't like set. If he wants you to actually set the screen and hold it, or if he wants you to get out quick so he can get downhill, so on and so forth. So it's just, those are some of the things that came into play. It was tough at some points in time, but that is always fixed with communication. And all those guys, most definitely, like, they were good to talk to. And I always, like, for sure, like picking their brain just to see, like, okay, if you want me to set this screen, how do you want me to set it? If you want me to set this screen here, how high, how low? Do you want it around the three-point line? Do you want it up at half court? You know, when it comes to just, like, open side pick and rolls, if it's a step up, do you want me to get in and get out? Do you want me to set the screen and hold it? Just tell me a way to get you downhill. Then after that, all you got to do is either get it on the rim and I'm coming to rebound because the big is going to have to come contest you, or throw the lob. Simple as that. Or if you throw a pocket pass, I'll make sure I catch it because I always want to make sure, like, I'm in the right position at the right time just to pretty much take at least some type of pressure off somebody, especially when they're getting trapped, when they're getting, I would say, hedged off hard. At the end of the day, I just want to be in that right position, right mindset, right headspace on where to be, how to do it, and when to do it.
So you got a lot of knowledge. Mm-hmm. You've had 6 coaches in 5 seasons.
Yeah.
Is it one of those situations, and I've had 6 in 1 year. Mm. You take bits and pieces from each one and try to incorporate it? Or is it more that you kind of agree with? A lot of coaches are like, yeah, that's not really my thing. Like, over the course of your career, how do you feel about having many coaches?
I really just took it one day at a time when it came to just like how many coaches that I've had, you know, because all of them were different. Just came in just ready to go because, like, you never knew what was going to – I always just came in just like with a clean slate. Didn't matter what happened yesterday. If we get a new way he acts today, okay, cool. That's how the coach is going to be today. If we get the same way he acted the day before, okay, cool. He acted the day before. So that's how I kind of paid attention to it. I just came in. I was just ready to work, you know. And then, like, if they asked me to do something, I did it. If they gave me the freedom to do something, I did it. And pretty much I just always made sure that, you know, they asserted what role was mine to just be played with the schemes offensively, defensively. Whatever y'all needed me to do on the floor, I'd do it at the end of the day, you know. Just at some point, like, there were, I would say, false promises, you know. You know how that gets. You know, guys telling you you're going to play. You know, you end up not playing. And it's like, okay, we had these conversations about, like, what you wanted me to do. I can't do that on the sideline. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So it's just, that's how I just looked at it. And I just kind of, like, maybe took a step back. And I learned how to be professional all over again with each one of the coaches that I played for. So I just, like I said, I just took it one day at a time. It was a lot of frustration, of course, that comes with the game, but I found ways to get through it at the end of the day.
You're known for your tenacity, your physical play. Mm-hmm. Has that always been like who you are? Has that come from, you know, college, being from Arkansas? Mm-hmm. You know, I kind of put you in the same category as like a Bobby Portis.
Yeah.
Both of y'all went to Arkansas.
Right.
Similar type of games, right?
Yeah. Most definitely. You know, just... that all comes from just like how hard, just like with my work ethic, it's been kind of like boiled down to where I'm from, for sure. Atmosphere was always different on a day to day basis in my neighborhood. It was rough, of course, but we made it. And having all of that just like up here, it just kind of like fueled me to just find some type of way to be able to get out of that. And for me to be able to get out of that, I had to go hard on the court. And for me to go hard on the court, I had to have the mindset of, like, I'm not going to get pushed around. I'm not going to let anybody step over me. And I'm not going to just come in here and just take advantage of anything. And that's what I felt like I did in Chicago the year and a half that I was there. I felt like I didn't take, like, the right advantage of all the opportunities that was given to me. So once I got traded, it's just kind of like I resetted myself. I was aggressive in Chicago, not even going to lie. But after that, it was just like I took another step on just how to approach the game, get my routine down. And once everything was kind of like solidified for me and I had like a system, that's when I was fully locked in. And then it's just like it just went up another level. And I watch anime a lot and stuff too. So all the screaming they do on Dragon Ball Z, that's literally like how like I was motivated. I was like, okay, they get stronger by screaming, you know what I'm saying? Maybe I can get better by screaming, you know? So every time I dunk, block a shot, it's just like a, you know, a good just feeling of relief once you get like all the tension out, once you get, in all honesty, I do this with just like everyday life too. Once you get all the tension out, once you get all the frustration, just everything is like bottled up inside. It's always good to just let it out. You ain't got to let it out in front of anybody if you're shy. At the end of the day, you can't just, you know, be in somebody's face and just scream. If you don't want to, like if you want to, be my guest. But just with me, for sure, like I always tell people, you know, dunking is my therapy. Basketball is my therapy. You know, people tell me to always be in my happy place, and they tell me your happy place should be on the floor. Even Gortat, he told me that, you know. So it's just like I try to find ways to just like alleviate all the pressure in life when it comes to just like the basketball side, the life side, all of that by doing just pretty much my job. And I mean, this job makes me happy. I have fun doing it and I'm going to continue to do it until, you know, the basketball stops bouncing. But at the end of the day, I just, you know, like I said, just getting all of that, you know, built up stuff out, it just really just helps me progress throughout my career.
You're a big family guy. Yeah. I've seen multiple interviews you talk about, you know, taking the responsibility of being a breadwinner for your entire family.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about the pressure that comes with the ability to be able to do that and mm-hmm. how that makes you feel.
I got a pretty good hold of it now. But when I first started, man, you know, you know, like when you first sign and stuff, it's like, okay, you know what's going on. You've right. read everything in the contract. You see the stuff on paper.
Right.
But it's like your family doesn't. No. And your friends doesn't. And your people around you, they don't know it either. So it's like, you know, they see the number beside your name and what you just signed. They're like, oh, he got that instantly as soon as he signed it.
No, they don't understand. Half phones, of them go to taxes.
Taxes. You know, you got agent other stuff fees. You got to deal with. Oh, my goodness, man. And, like, you try and explain this to the people that, you know, are asking, and they're just like, we don't want to hear that. We see plenty of other dollars right. besides your name, besides what you're getting rid of already. So it's just like the pressure side, most definitely it got to me at first. I really didn't know how to handle it. You know, I was always kind of like a yes guy mm-hmm. for sure, especially with my mom, because just like with how she went through life having to take care of me and my siblings, it's just like, you know, you want to take care of mom. You want to take care of dad, too, because right. my dad, he had to come back and be around me and my youngest brother because he made a phone call with us. He was like, you guys want me to come back? We said yes. He came back. There's a lot of stuff the city and like just pretty much life in general did to him. He was basically homeless. And so both of them wanted to take care of them. So it's like whatever they asked for, it was like I wanted to.
Right.
At one point, I was giving. I was like, yeah, I'm real gullible right now. I'm just going to go ahead and do it, right. you know, because I want to see them happy. But it's like, man, my numbers are slowly going down. So, you know, whew, now I really got to do some thinking, especially when they start asking. It's like, if I keep giving you this, I'm not going to be able to give you anymore.
Right.
So I really had to get to the point to where it's like, okay, the pressure really got to a point to where it just like boiled over. And I'm just like going off of my mom, going off of my dad. I'm like, y'all can't keep asking me for stuff. If y'all keep asking me, I'm not going to be able to keep giving it to you.
Right.
You want a house. You want a car. My mom, she wants jewelry. She wants clothes, shoes, all of that. I can't do that if I'm broke. So like I had to really just like, and you know, they from the South, so you gotta say it a couple of like more than three times for sure. So it's just like when it comes to that, once I got the gist of it, you know, like I said, it was tough. It was a lot of frustration. Did a lot of crying too, you know. And that was just like one of the things that I didn't want to do. I didn't want to hear my mom cry. I for sure didn't want to hear my pops cry, you know. So like I said, when the pressure boiled over, that's when I had to take a step back, reevaluate the situation, how I was going to actually, like, address it, you know? And so I just told both of them, I was like, if y'all just have just, like, a small amount of patience with me, just let me build myself up. I'm trying to at least find me a foundation right now. This is my first year in the league. Y'all are for sure, like, adding more pressure than any NBA team could add to me right now.
Right.
Just because of the simple fact that y'all want so much in so little time. I can't do that with just, like, how much money I'm getting in and how much money they're taking away from me as I'm bringing that money in.
Right.
So it's just, like I said, they're from the South, I had to say it more than three times. So once they finally got just like an idea of what I was trying to get them to understand, that's what made it easier. And that just throughout my career, I would say around maybe my fourth year, like last year, yeah, that's when like I fully got like a handle on it. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, you know, this is going to go to you, mom. This is going to go to you, dad. Y'all are set.
High school, you went through a traumatic experience.
Yeah. Car wreck?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. I went through a traumatic experience as well. Mm-hmm. It was more basketball for me. I was playing an AU tournament, mm-hmm. went up for a dunk, got undercut, ruptured my spleen. Bled out for 4 days, was supposed to die.
That's tough.
You obviously went through some traumatic car wreck, flipped four times. Mm-hmm. I know what it did for me as far as like how it helped me to focus coming out of that situation. Mm-hmm. Talk about kind of what it meant for you.
I was given a second chance, most definitely. I got the picture on my phone and everything. I always take a look at it. Just because of the simple fact that I wanted to spend a couple of extra hours being like around friends and stuff, you know. Like, the person that I rode up there with, he had left already. And he had told me, he was like, okay. He asked me, was I sure? And, like, I even hesitated to, just like, say yes at the end of the day, too. So, like, I was thinking in the back of my head, just, like, if I don't get home at a certain time, you know, even though I was about to get ready to go to college, my mom was going to go just, like, bonkers, you know. Pretty sure. I always, like, she used to always scream my name every time I was outside too long. You know, and it always, like, replays in the back of my head. Even if, like, when I'm out late now as a grown man, I still hear it, you know. But so, yeah, it was, like, it was a bit of hesitation for me. Just, like, staying out for a decent amount of time at that point in time. You know, high school kid, I wanted to kind of, like, be around everybody, which was rare. You know, it was kind of, like, maybe, like, my fifth time being out in my lifetime around that time. Went with literally two of the guys that I, like, have grown up with in diapers and, you know, did all that stuff that night. One of my friends, he had to be at work at 6 o'clock in the morning that next morning. And we stayed there, and we were in another city, maybe like 30 minutes from my hometown, until like 3 o'clock in the morning. I remember, like, we left, of course. We were all laughing and stuff, getting in the car, you know, of course. I'm thinking, like, okay, we're going to get home safe. End of the day. As soon as we get kind of like on that main road, it's like the longest boring 30-minute drive ever. All you see is trees. Everything looks the same. I fall asleep, of course. Like, that was already planned. I was going to fall asleep. The guy in the backseat, he fell asleep too. And if I'm not mistaken, you know, he lost control of the car trying to get it back on the road, but I think he fell asleep on the wheel too. So I wake up. We're on the left side of the road. And all I see is, like, grass and stuff. So I'm thinking, like, he's going to, you know, of course, stop. And I think that he tried to actually get back on the road, and that's when he fully lost control of it and we flipped. And I got thrown in the backseat. The guy in the backseat, he got thrown out of the car. And the driver, he got pinched in. So once I kind of, like, realized what's going on, I crawled out of the car. I'm like, oh, my God, what just happened? I see him. He finally gets out. And I'm glad I actually saw this because the car was smoking. If I would have never like went back in and turned the car off, it probably would have exploded while we were in there. So when it comes to all of that, you know, this is the funny part too. When everybody like came, got us, put us in the ambulance and stuff, the only thing that I'm thinking is, where's my phone? Like, I couldn't find my phone nowhere. It was looking through the bushes. I had, like, me and my dad was just out there like, please. Can we just go home? But no, most definitely.
Did you find the phone?
Yeah. No, we didn't.
No.
We didn't. Not at all. But for sure, just like that whole experience, like for it to be my first time to be in like an actual car accident, to just kind of like think on like what could have been, it could have been way worse. Like the worst injury was a broken shoulder. I had cuts and bruises on my arm from glass. And then My other friend, he had a bruised rib. That's pretty much it. And just going back on that, I always think back. It's like, what if neither one of us made it out of that? You know? And I always say, it's like, of course, you know, I'm blessed because I got a second chance at life. And from that point on, I got to a point to where it's like, okay, we really need to lock in with just like the important stuff when it comes to life, because every day isn't promised. And most definitely my timeline was almost done then, you know?